right away, we are going to begin with the next session. That's the panel discussion. It's on do's and don'ts of project management in hospital projects, which will be moderated by Mr. Samir Mehta, who is the director of projects, HOSMAC Private Limited. And the panel members are Ipsita Mahajan, who's the development director, master's management consultants. Then Atul Adaniya, joint director operations, National Cancer Institute. K. Sujatha, who's the center head, Wockhardt, and Anand Chati, who's the principal coordinator, Chati Associates. So I'd like to call upon Samir Mehta with a brief introduction. So Samir has acquired master's in healthcare planning, and he's a facility planner by training with acquired learning in the fields of architecture and engineering. And as business head of HOSMAC projects, he anchors the strategic business units of turnkey design services, project management consultancy, equipment consulting group, and EPC build services. So with this, I'd request Samir Mehta to be on the dais, please. And introduce our rest of the panel members.
Thank you. Thank you, Faizan. Good morning, everyone. Before I introduce the panel members, thought it right to share the reasoning behind choosing this as a topic for panel discussion and the pertinence of it. The lot among the audience who are in the process of establishing a hospital, and there are some who have hospitals and are undergoing or in the process of attempting renovation, which is a challenge in itself. We have designers who design the building, but it's quite an effort to execute this on the floors and get it done, because you have different trades coming in together to set up this establishment that we speak of. You have civil contractors, you have MEP contractors spanning fire safety, plumbing, electrical, air conditioning, medical gases. You have a myriad team of consultants, right from somebody who does a liaising with the authorities locally to get the permissions, to green consultants, to architects, to engineering consultants, project management consultant, which is our subject today. So there is a certain understanding of what PMC stands for in the market, and which is what I'll briefly broach upon. It's commonly understood to be managing the triad of cost, quality, and time. That's what project management is commonly perceived to be. There's a larger perspective where PMC is seen to be an agency which is brought on board even before you commission the project. Commission the project in terms of articulating the project. So the first agency that you bring on board is a PMC, who in turn will bring on board your medical planners, architects, consultants, etc., also facilitate the construction. The more commonly perceived notion in India is that project management is to do with construction management. So there is a difference. You have PMC, which has a larger role, and you have CMC, which is construction management, which has a relatively limited role. So we need to understand, is it PMC that is more pertinent to us? Is it CMC that is more pertinent to us? It is very important today to seek professional help in managing the projects, because any overrun in terms of time and quality hits the bottom line hard, and it pinches, because healthcare by itself, projects are an expensive proposition. If you look at it from an operational perspective, there's something that's gone wrong in course of execution. It comes back to bite you later. God forbid you have to take shutdowns, and that again hits your bottom lines. So there's a general consensus that PMC is important, but to understand how it matters to us, we have four panel members, two who bring in an inside perspective, two who bring in an outside perspective. So we have with us Mr. Chati, who has close to 20 years of experience in this. He is an architect, but has been managing projects, almost over 3 million square feet of spaces that he has worked with, both as designers and as project manager. That's to do with, he's into architecture, interiors, landscaping, and is also handling certain hospital projects here, so he'll bring an inside perspective. We have with us Ms. Ipsita Mahajan, who is the center head for Wockhardt, close to 9 years now. Yeah, she's leading it from the front. K. Sujatha, sorry. And we have Ms. Ipsita Mahajan, who is with Masters, She's been a practicing architect and almost 20 years of experience now, combined with project management. Both these ladies are gold medalists, so a fillip to women power. And we have with us Dr. Atul Adaniya, who's a medical doctor, who's a healthcare management expert, who's an academician. He's led senior leadership roles in HN Hospital, Jaslok Hospital, and so he brings an outside perspective of how projects happen in hospital. So shall I welcome Anand? Can you please come on the dais? Sujatha, can we have you on? Sujatha also happens to be an alumni. She and I are from the same school. Ipsita, can we have you on the stage? Dr. Adaniya. So I think we'll start with an insider's perspective, and this question goes to Anand and then to Ipsita. How would you define PMC? Not a textbook, but you know, how you've seen it happening in course of your...
Thank you very much, Samir. For me, PMC, I'll a little elaborate in a different way. I'll put in an example to explain a PMC. Let's imagine an automobile. You have a lot of parts, a lot of things that actually define an automobile. So let's correlate a few elements with the project. We have engine, which is the soul of an automobile, which is the core team, the doctors, the clinicians. We have the vehicle with a wheel, which we call as a contractors, and the actual labor workforce. Then we have the battery, we have the fuel, which is actually nothing but the finances and the funds. So now just imagine who is driving this. Can the project run with only the batteries, with only the fuel, with only the tires? No. The project is driven with the teamwork, and to lead the teamwork, you need a driver who actually maneuvers the vehicle, and for me, that is the role of a PMC. A PMC would actually maneuver everyone, define the timeline, define the speed, define where to change the gear, where to put a brake, and that is what, in a larger perspective, I would say PMC's role is like a driver. Not the bookish style, but in a very practical way.
Absolutely. Ipsita, your take?
Well, I think the analogy is very interesting, and he's very apt about it. Probably I would also use another analogy. I would say in an age of specialization, sometimes what happens is you need the generalist who will put everything together. So just as you have a general practitioner, a GP, who most people don't think about anymore, but he's an important guy because he understands what the patient is all about, the psychology to each and every patient. And then you have all the specialists. So when you go to somebody with an ailment and he knows you, and then he says, okay, so you have it and this is your history, and so you need to be doing this. So I think in an age of specialization, a PMC is a generalist. As he rightly pointed out, it's a person who has to take the responsibility for delivery of the project. So you take the responsibility for that person to make sure he gets well again.
Very well put.
So that's how it is.
Now, an outside inside perspective, this is to Dr. Adaniya and then to Sujatha. Are the owner stakeholders open to engaging consultants, or do they prefer to have these resources employed in-house?
I'll put this way. Let's look at the ground reality, how exactly is happening. Isn't PMC reduced practically to only construction management around us? That's the hard fact. Yes, it seems or it feels nice that that's the driver or that's the fuel or that's the source, that's the petrol in the car. But that's what is not happening. PMC gets involved usually at the construction stage, and then they manage construction. The timelines, the deadlines, and that's it. But this is exactly what is happening on the ground.
they're reduced to that part. But yes, the vision, theoretical vision, what you say, is, was supposed to be done. I can proudly say I've been associated with two projects and we're able to get those things done that way. But the insight about the need for PMC or the right relevance or the right role definition for them is still not well understood by the industry. That's one in my view.
So as a person, Dr. Adaniya, who's been through, you know, projects, you know, despite not handling projects directly, but being part of the team that manage projects, would you say that, you know, they need to be brought in, brought on board early on, or is it okay to bring them on just before the construction
at
commences?
At the initial stage itself.
You think so?
That's when they'll execute that role which we're envisioning for that matter. It's not only the construction management, the process planning, the resource utilization, and even for that matter, how things will work. Even budget, they have to be part of each of those things. Only then you'll get the fruitful and desired results at the end result, how it comes across.
Sujatha, have you seen Wockhardt Nagpur undergoing some kind of renovation, upgradation?
Yeah. So I'll put it this way. Project management need not necessarily be a tool that you use when you are starting up a new setup or starting a construction of a hospital, but it's essentially a scientific tool which you can use also in your day-to-day operations. And if you have some specific projects that you want to undertake, so one of those projects could be expansion or maybe creating a new specialty or kickstarting a newer, expanding your existing setup kind of a thing. So going to the question that you asked that whether we should have an external consultant, I personally feel that we should have an external consultant. Of course, for Nagpur unit, we did, when we started about 10, 12 years back, so Wockhardt is a very big corporate with a lot of projects going on. So when there is a bigger institution with multiple projects going on, it's okay if you have your own team, because then the project management team can go from one project to another project to another project, and then once they have completed the project, they can hand it over to the operational team. But if you are a smaller unit, especially for Nagpur, where most of the hospitals are either owned by an individual doctor or a group of doctors. So we see a lot of hospitals coming up in Nagpur where a set of doctors start up a setup. So in that case, it is better we use a separate professional team of expert, project management consultant. So at Wockhardt, we have not had an opportunity so far because we started a hospital and then there was nothing in between. So, you know, you can also use the project management team for smaller projects like NABH implementation or maybe a new software. Again, as I said, since we are a bigger corporate, we have our in-house team who helped us doing it. But for smaller setup, it is advisable if they go and take help of a professional expert in this area.
All right, thanks, Sujatha. This one is for you, Dr. Adaniya. For those among the audience who are looking to establish hospitals and think they will need professional help, as a person who's gone through the motion, you know, what is the kind of credentials of PMC that you would look for?
Is this audible?
Yes.
Okay, perfect, thank you. Credential, that's a tricky thing for that matter, because how many people even understand the word credentials? Not to put people down in that respect, yes. Obviously, experience in handling this kind of thing, which is limited by choice. Sujatha said they have lots of, because they have done lots of projects in hospital. So they've developed an in-house team. What is credential is right here. People who have gained insight about things, what is required, not only from the construction point of view, I'm re-emphasizing that point. Also, how things work in hospital. What are the service mix? What are the nitty-gritties of patient movement, patient flows, or even perspectives and issues like infection control practices.
So what you're saying is understanding operations is integral to, you
much,
know,
much more
being a qualified project manager.
You might
manager.
Not be an architect, is fine, but understanding hospital operation from industry point of view is much more important. That I will hold as the first credential for the person. Having support from architectural team can initially be provided to that person. That's not an issue. That will be my first and foremost, understanding of hospital operations.
If I can add, see, every project management consultant of what I've heard and what I've experienced have their separate set of strengths and weaknesses. So it's when we want to do a particular project in our hospital, or if there is an individual person here who wants to set up a hospital, when you are going and meeting a project management consultant, it is very important that you spend time to talk to the person who's actually going to handle your project and try to understand whether the strengths and weaknesses of that firm is in concurrence with your requirement, because every project management consultant firm will have a different requirement. It may not match the requirement that you have at your existing setup or your own need at that point of time. So one of the most important credentials before you choose a project management consultancy is to see what their strengths and weaknesses are, which are the areas they have already worked in, which are the major projects they've already assisted in. And if you have a good networking, you may even call back and get a reference check for these consultancies.
So I'll say, go and see it yourself. Why hold back? Nobody's going to highlight the sad points.
Yeah.
I've done a big thing.
Do a ref check.
Go and see yourself.
All right, Anand, this one comes for you. What in your experience has been the most crucial aspect of project management? You've been through, you are undergoing a process of managing a hospital project. So what do you think was the most crucial so far?
Samir, to elaborate this little further, there are different dynamics associated with each project. Each project in itself is a different project. You cannot create a template which can be replicated in every project. So for me, the biggest challenge, I would say, so far has not, but then to highlight a few, is to understand the vision of the team. And that is where, at the forefront of the deliverable end, we need, as a project manager, we need to understand what is expected from the project, from the team members. So that is going to be the most key element in a success of a PMC.
So when you have stakeholders which are as diverse as somebody from a finance background and a lot of healthcare practitioners, how do you attempt to bring about a convergence of views so that you do not lose on time? Have you faced this?
Yes, in every projects that we have done, the typical challenge is to get the focus of every member onto the vision. And to overcome this, you can only suggest that you need more interaction, more understanding meetings, more kickoffs, more kind of those arrangements. And you have to be open.
You need to be talking more.
You need to be talking more. You need to be listening more, not just talking, listening more. Understanding what is exactly expected from a project. And to bring down that, I would say, as a PMC, the biggest quality is to be open to unlearn, because we create a lot of carbon copies in our mind. And as I said earlier, that none of the projects are similar. None of the projects are typical, in fact. So we need to unlearn that we have learned. And that is where the success of a PMC would lie.
Ipsita, your take. You handle quite a few medical centers. So have you faced this challenge of getting convergence, sign-offs?
Yes, actually, I would agree with exactly what he said. Just want to add one more layer onto it. I think it's not only about understanding what people say, because when people say something, they often mean something else. So very often, we have to preempt what is it that they need. And we need to be able to show them sometimes also a path where they can go. It's something like being a coach. See, Tendulkar can be a fantastic player, but you have to be able to take a step back, watch how he plays, and then add that extra level which maybe even Tendulkar doesn't know he can do today. So sometimes it's not only about listening to others. Definitely listening is extremely important, but it's also about knowing what they can achieve and getting them to move in that direction. And I think one of the major issues that we do face in projects, to be honest about it, is ego management. Because everybody, as you were saying, everyone believes that, we all believe, including me, that we understand everything. But unless you are willing to learn from every step, I think Mr. Verma also pointed that out, that you make mistakes, you learn from it, you don't get anywhere. So we need to manage everybody and make sure that we're all going the same direction.
Okay, Ipsita, this one again comes for you. We all know theoretically a budget is something that you establish at the outset. It doesn't always happen, or if it does, it could undergo substantial change. In your experience, when is it typically done in Indian healthcare projects? You know, when do you articulate a project estimate which is not too far from what it should be or could be?
Well, I think the success of a project is if you can do that early on, because then you sort of, you know, you are able to manage also the expectation. In my world, I think that very often we mix up two things. One is budget and one is a cost plan. Budget is the money which I have in my wallet today, which I am able to spend on a project, on achieving a particular vision. The cost plan is what it actually costs. So I might say I have a 10,000 rupees and I have the aspiration for an iPhone. But the project manager's job is to create then the cost plan for, okay, you've designed all this, it's beautiful. So what is the budget you have? Okay, let's keep that aside. Against this design, what is going to be the cost? That's something else. Then we need to figure out how to marry the two. Very often the problem is that when we interchange these words and then we get into a big mess later on.
That, and there is often a huge divergence between, you know, what you initially set out to and what you end up with. How do you manage that, Anand?
I would agree and take the word forward from Ipsita that, you know, a budget is something which you figure out right in the beginning of a project. Then once that budget is set right, got approval, then you need to keep that in tab. That is where the role of a...
Are you doing that, Anand, in your practice? Are you seeing your owners agreeing to meet up to discuss the budgets and, you know, how it has moved from what it was initially set out to be?
See,
just trying to understand if this happens.
Yes. This has to happen. And in almost all our projects, we do the initial budgeting. We call it as a budget, but there is always a confusion between a budget and an estimate and a cost.
Correct.
So when we say that we budget something, we need to explain it to the proponents that yes, these are going to be the key areas where you need to spend a little more. You need to spend a little. You can cut cost here. Cost saving is going to be the later part of the PMC or the CMC. So where you can control it. But as a matter of fact, the budget needs to be linked with the aspirations and the vision of the team. So once that is done, you need to again relook into the budget at every moment of time that, okay, now we have come to a middle stage of a project where your construction is happening. It is always, you know, taken care by the execution team. Then there are, in the particular case of a hospital, there are at least 20 areas where you know, your budget can go really haywire. And with the advent of new technologies, it is again very difficult to figure out. So I would always suggest, and in practice we do that, we review the budgets at every milestones.
You do.
And that is where we are always linked with the team and their vision.
One of the reasons the budgets often go haywire is changes. You know, change, they say, is the essence of life, but change is the bane of healthcare projects. So this is open to all the four panelists here. We know that changes usually have a significant time and cost implication. How easy or difficult has it been to manage a change, and how have you done it? I'll start with Dr. Adaniya.
Change is bound to come. The market demands change, or the business needs itself what you want to.
But sir, then that is because it's not been articulated as it should have been in the initial stage.
Obviously, it's going to have its implication, but sane person will try and inbuilt these expected changes right in the beginning, but you cannot visualize everything. By the time you progress to the final stages, the technology or the available for a particular...
Can I just intervene here? Ipsita, do you agree that you cannot visualize it at the inception?
Well, to some extent, I think about 80% you should be able to, because otherwise you've really failed. 20% I do agree, you know, a lot of technology keeps moving up. And that is something which we need to build in into our design so that we can accommodate it. There are many renovation projects we are doing. Now that is also in a way a change when you think about it. A hospital has been built earlier. I think Sujatha also mentioned that. And then we are now looking at upgrading that. And very often sometimes the design allows, sometimes it doesn't allow. So
that is by intent.
Yeah, correct.
But here is a situation where you have, you know,
conceptualized
the project.
In the course of a project, I don't think it should, unless the project takes really long. You know, if we have a quick turnaround time, it should not be a challenge.
So the construction cost or the time cost, they can still be thought about and all. What I'm referring to is the market demands, the business needs, or new legal statutory implications. Most importantly is technological changes. They are advancing so fast. By the time you reach something, it's totally topsy-turvy change. And obviously, when you're building up something new, as I always say, top the line, state of art, you have to justify them as well. This is bound to come.
You've seen changes at close quarters,
yes,
sir.
Absolutely.
You are seeing that.
Yes. So much more closer than I can imagine, right now as well as earlier as you were.
So how difficult has it been to manage this? Has it had implications?
Last time it wasn't in HN.
Mm-hmm.
That was a budgetless project. But those kind of projects you can't have. Na bhuto na bhavti, I can tell you for sure. Budgetless projects can't be there. So there the time runs didn't matter. Other cost implications didn't matter. Now it does affect us for that matter. We've been able to surmount them partly.
But how is your tough, Ipsita?
I think, your doctor. Okay, so doctors rightly articulated that technology changes like anything. I mean, I go and buy that same iPhone which we are talking about, and you buy 6 and suddenly there's 7 in the market. But we have to manage the aspiration also. And so, I mean, if the client definitely has aspiration, they have the budget, we should be able to accommodate it. So I don't think we should be scared of change. But this, yes, that has an impact. If we all are able to accept that impact, then there is no reason why, you know, it cannot be accommodated in a project. I mean,
Anand, reasonable. How easy has it been for the users to understand the implications of change?
It's really difficult. Difficult to explain from a PMC perspective or from a consultant perspective how it is going to, you know, really hit it. But the change is inevitable in a design and a hospital scenario. It is going to be there. And I keep that part always open from my end, unless and until it is really sealed and locked. So it really hits for a project in terms of timelines and budgets. But then that is where you need to, you know, factor in the beginning. That is where you need the vision of the team, need the vision of everybody on the board to be aligned. Why?
And yet it does not happen.
It does happen.
It happens. It's inevitable. Change is inevitable.
Okay. Sujatha, your take?
No, see, there are sometimes very practical reasons also for which a change happens. Like, I'll share a live example what happened. So when 2007, we were constructing our Wockhardt multi-speciality hospital, 130-bedded hospital. Now, the initial plan, so what is important if you really don't want to have too many changes in your project, during your project, what is very important is we have a very, very nice, robust master plan where you articulate everything, you know, kind of what should be your bed mix, what is the sophistication of infrastructure and equipment you want in your hospital, the level. But then when we were constructing this hospital, so we had decided upon everything. And we had thought in the beginning of the project that we will not have a cath lab in our setup. But during the course of the project, we realized that it is going to be a multi-speciality hospital and all services are going to be there. So it actually doesn't make sense that a cardiac emergency comes and you are not able to cater to them in your hospital. So midway of the project, we decided that no, the hospital should also have a cath lab. So now the drawing and design and everything was in place. So what we had to do, so we had to actually convert a huge general ward area, 23-bedded general ward area. And then we had to put a cath lab. And then the machine had to be got inside the hospital. The building was already constructed. So you had to make provision of how you're going to get the cath machine into the department. So, but then these kind of changes
are inevitable.
Are practical changes. See, they when we were going through the process of the project, we realized that this is one change which is going to be beneficial for the patient also and for us also. So such kind of changes also come where the organizational thinking or strategy towards what kind of hospital they want to have also changes. So, you know, and end of the day, it helps the patient. See, we have to understand we're in a hospital business. So end of the day, we have to have a hospital which is able to, you know, give all kinds of services to our patients. So, yes, such kind of changes also happen.
You
it is
to,
very
so you
difficult.
It
was a nightmare doing all. We had already constructed the general wards.
That simply
so it
defines
nightmare.
Between whether you have those clients or you're out of the ambit of those services.
Yeah, absolutely.
So if you need to, there are ways of doing it. The question here is, you know, could it have been foreseen? And could the cost implications of this change been avoided if it had been foreseen? But that's another story. We'll leave it at that.
Yeah. No, see, again, I'm saying why I said it's practical is because we already have a cardiac setup here. So initially, we thought we don't want to have a cardiac setup. So, but then the organizational strategy changes with time. So
Anand and Ipsita, this one's for you. It's a little technical. We have something called quantity surveyors. So I wanted their take on whether it's okay to have construction and management and quantity surveyors surveying being done by the same consulting agency. Is that fine? Construction management and quantity surveying.
I would always prefer two being separate. You know.
Could you share your reasons?
Yes. Let us understand how many people are there on the board when the hospital is being done. First, you have a PMC, as we have all agreed that that is going to be the first agency or the consultant on the board. Then we identify the right architect who does it. Then we have the hospital planning consultant. Then we have the business plan consultant. We have the experts from the financial field. We have the clinicians and the doctors. We have the people who are going to run. That can always add to the value of it. The biggest challenge that a project would always face is going to be the what is the exact quantity that is going to be executed. So if tomorrow I'm an architect and I'm quantifying my own project, I may be little unbiased or a little biased in terms of.
There could be a conflict of interest.
There can be a conflict of interest. So it's always advisable to get the third party to be on board to check it. What we call as normally the technical auditors. So it's always advisable to have more people who can throw open the wounds, and give a actual real picture of the project.
So Ipsita, is it a quantity surveyor agency that will undertake the measurements at site and certify?
It depends. There are some projects where the QS is also done by the PMC. I would agree that the advantage of having QS quantity surveyor separate is that you have a second layer of oversight. But even when you do it together, you create a firewall. So you have a separate team. So the project management team and the quantity surveyor team are the same.
Sure. My check.
And when
hello.
Sorry.
That's mine.
Okay. And coming back to your question, I'm sorry, I've missed the
No, that's okay. The next one again is for you.
To add something to it.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Just to,
but aren't you creating one more additional layer,
that's what
which will create more time runs and time delays by having two separate groups?
It is an internal check and audit, sir.
That's true, but when we say two separate groups having it, why can't it be in-house? Or one group itself looking after both the aspects? Isn't it related?
That depends upon the scale of the project.
No, let's say it's a magnanimous scale. Let's say it's a 400-bedded hospital. I have one team, because it's principally overlapping in functions in many regards. Why can't the same team do both the aspects? That's a query I have.
I think there is a little confusion in terms of the JDs. Of the agencies.
No, the query is, yes. Why should we have two
audible?
Separate teams?
I don't think it's necessary to have two separate teams.
That's exactly
it's
what
about
he
the
asked.
Qualification
That's
of
what
the
he
team.
Asked it. Why should we have two separate teams? Why am I getting impression we should have two separate teams? I think it will create more overlaps and more time overruns.
No,
why not have one?
It would never have
please.
See, when we say that we have the quantity surveyors and the PMCs and the architects who are running parallelly, it divides the time. It never overruns. It always divides the time. It would never overrun.
But the still, why two teams?
It's a kind of a technical audit that has been becomes necessary.
I'm
in
sorry
the
to differ, but I feel one team can.
Yeah, that's okay.
Us.
I mean, we are there not to agree but to disagree. At certain point of time.
But I wanted to enlighten myself to why two. I have always believed
it's
one was
not
in the interest of
in
transparency,
fact,
there is
yes.
a body called International Federation of Consulting Engineers, which has set up a framework of how a contract should be administered. So unlike the contracts that are typically drawn up in India, which are biased in favor of the owners, this is one which is more balanced. Ipsita, I wanted your take on, you worked with international firms, designers. How common is the use of FIDIC in India?
So FIDIC is not used in India, and I actually feel sorry about that, because I think that, you know, the problem of a project is that sometimes we go into the project with a lot of mistrust. So the client hires a PMC, but they don't trust. You hire a contractor, nobody trusts the contractor. Whereas actually the contractor is the guy who's going to deliver your project. It's like going to a cardiac surgeon and not trusting what he's going to do. You know, so you're wondering, like, you know, my heart is open, he's doing the surgery, and but I don't trust him. So I think the challenge is that. And so when you have a fair contract, what are you doing? You're creating a platform where everybody feels that their angle or their you know, interest is also fairly met with. See, if I am going to continually mistrust you all the time, you will also feel that. And then you will tend to react in that way. So the best kind of project, and I know that this is not easy to achieve. I mean, from my own experience, there are very few in 20 years. I would say there are about two or three projects where we could work like that. But the result you get in that is completely different. And I think FIDIC contracts are it's a standard which I think we should try to definitely apply. One of the major problems in the industry, I think, which we all face is payments. So whether you're a consultant or you're a contractor or even the client, you know, this whole thing. So, you know, once somebody is, why would someone not deliver? It's in everybody's interest to deliver. The contractor gets credit, the client credit, everyone gets credit. So I think FIDIC and these kind of, you know, fair contracts should be applied.
Fair enough. Anand, what would be the composition of a typical construction management team? Who monitors and manages quality in the team?
Yeah, ideally, when we say that an ideal construction management team, how it should be. At the core, it has to be the vision of the team, which is aligned with the project. So your PMC is going to be there, who can orient the team.
Anand, my question was in terms of what kind of skill sets do you require to constitute?
Yes, I'm coming to that. I'm coming to that. So when I say that, you need to concentrate on the deliverables from the CMC point of view. You need the people who have the right knowledge of the latest technologies that are happening, the typical record keeping and the bookkeeping that is necessary. So, for an example, if the pour card is not there, how do you then pinpoint that whether this particular batch of concrete was correct or not? So these basics, see, it is all related to basic of engineering and civil engineering. So it is the civil engineering team that is necessary and important. And I always believe in a third party audit when it comes to the quality. So I would always have an association with the quality surveyors and the labs, who can then check periodically and give a surprise visits and check the quality of construction.
Okay, let me rephrase, Anand. The question was, we typically conceive a construction management team to comprise of, to consist of civil engineers,
yes,
you know, and the ilk. Question is, who's the planning engineer, who does the documentation control, and who does the QC at site? You can get it done externally, true. But do you think there are dedicated resources required for these functions
as
a part of the team?
It is one of the biggest document that is required from a CMC side. So it is the CMC that takes care of this. Through the contractor again, because, you know, it's a joint effort. So on site, on ground, it is going to be the contractor's people, and we need to identify the right people from the contractor side who can do this. It is not a single man's job, it is a teamwork. So a supervisor who is actually supervising the concrete or the
can
work...
Can also do the QC.
Yeah, can also do the QC.
All right. We will have a lot of, you know, among the audience who will be, you know, going forward awarding tenders, you know, for work to happen. How important is it to pre-qualify contractors is a question to Dr. Adaniya. Outside perspective, management perspective.
Obviously, it's vital. That's the right way of doing things, and there is no substitute for doing a thing right.
But it also happens, especially in smaller towns or even in bigger cities. You know,
I know somebody,
he will do it for me.
He has done something, have some ideas, so I enroll them. That's how we keep doing it.
Yeah.
But if you see the professional way of doing it, definitely you should pre-qualify, get the credentials on, get the right people on board.
Can I
usually add? Doesn't happen that way, to be straightforward.
See, basically, what is pre-qualifying a pre-qualifying a contractor? What it is actually, the process is that you create a benchmark by your own self, wherein you categorize that what are the categories which a contractor has to necessarily fulfill to actually apply for the job that you want
him
to do.
Sorry for interrupting. What we'll do? What suits my friend or the person, I'll put those into there, and that's how it.
Yeah, that's how it gets done. But then I think, sir, things are changing in towns like Nagpur now. People are actually, so again, I'm saying, when you pre-qualify a contractor, it need not necessarily be a paper document where you just put down that A, B, C, D, E, he should fulfill to come and talk to me or apply for the job. You can also do is mentally prepare a check note as to what are the pre-qualifications you want from that contractor, what is the experience you want, what kind of contracts you want him to have already worked with, what is the financial stability of that contractor you want, and then you can just interview him and try to probe out and find out which are the qualifications he fits in. But then I think the method of just doing it because your friend has also done it, no longer should be done because we are in a very complex business and it's getting, it's an industry in itself. So it's better to use such kind of a technology where.
That's why we have messier projects being managed. They're not being done the
right
way.
So it's very, very genuine to pre-qualify your contractor and then only give him a job rather than just going
Anand,
by
we have this concept of turnkey contractors where a single agency comes on board to undertake all aspects of contracting execution. Would you recommend that to your clients?
No, I would never.
Your reasons?
Like I said, if we have to go by a turnkey, both the parties need to be very sure what is expected from each of us. Unless and until that is going to happen, that is going to be written down, I would never advise anybody to go for a turnkey job.
And you and I are going to differ a lot today.
I'm most welcome, sir.
No, this is interesting, Ipsita.
I would like to add something to this because recently we have not done, not hospital projects, I would say, but we have recently done two projects which are pretty interesting. One is based on the design and build strategy, which is typically followed for infrastructure. But now, a lot of people, as you were saying, they want.
So I'll come to that, Ipsita. Hold on. I want to broach that as a separate question. Turnkey contractors, would you endorse?
For a hospital, probably not, only because of the complexity. If the contractor has capability, I wouldn't know. India, I have my doubts.
Okay. I'll say exactly because of the complexity, have somebody who has turnkey, somebody who has insight and experience and exposure and a good team, which is capable of delivering everything. The communication needs reduced.
So that's the inside-outside perspective you all can see.
So exactly. For the same reason, since it's complex and since a tried and tested team, they have all resources in-house. Why?
Oh, that's what I'm saying, that if you have that resource in-house, it makes sense. But what typically happens is that the civil guy takes the job and then he offloads it onto a number of
We haven't seen contractors of the ilk who has all the word with in-house.
That's where I'm saying. Otherwise I don't think there's any issue. You will land up paying a little bit more for the coordination charge, but that's worth it. So I do understand that the headache is less, the billing is coordinated, a lot of things are coordinated, because even the resources which a contractor provides, say you have scaffolding or you have water, power, whatever, so one guy providing it and sharing it with others, it makes sense. But the only reason why I said no is because I have not found many people who are able to do that.
So what you're saying, it's better to have a turnkey thing if you have the right
guy. Right guy. Absolutely.
Okay, we have a few more questions, but owing to positive time, a last one at the panelists. Design build contracts, your perspective about it. Anand, we could start with you. In healthcare, pertinent to healthcare.
Design build contracts are normally what is accepted in the healthcare industry that what
you
I
see
understood.
From the owner's perspective.
Yeah, I'm
no,
seeing
I don't
from
have
the
to
owner's
think
perspective.
About anything, design, execution,
yes.
All done, ready.
Yes,
to
from the owner's
skin
perspective,
skin.
I'm just giving you the insight. So it's always better to have a design build contract when it comes to one-on-one deliverables. So if I say I have a vision and my team is lean and I want the hospital or infrastructure to look like this, the machinery has to be there. So your vision and the clarity has to be thorough in terms of going with the design and build. Otherwise, it is going to be again the same thing that you know, you keep on hiring different people. And the biggest point that I would like to highlight is what Ipsita has again said a little while ago, is trust between the two. Unless and until you have a mutual trust between the person who is going to design and build, you cannot create anything. So that is my take, absolute from the inside.
Given a choice, Sujatha, would you award your work to as a design build contract?
I don't know, given an opportunity, what I would do. But then what I understand from this build and contract thing is, as an organization, we will have to see in that project which is more beneficial. So build and design gives a certain amount of benefit. As in, you don't have to go to different people. There is you don't have to spend more. So there is one agency to whom you go, you say just design, build, and they coordinate amongst themselves. And so it definitely gives you an advantage. But there is a disadvantage from a perspective that you don't get too much of leverage in terms of the design aspect, because if you have a separate architect and a separate builder, you get more leverage in terms of creative thinking and changes which can happen between both these agencies. So as a promoter, if the promoter wants to has, you know, paucity of time, or he doesn't want to get too much of involved into the entire process, I would suggest he can definitely try for build and design. But if he wants to get involved at each stage of designing and building, I would suggest him to go for separate entities.
Ipsita, does design build impede design?
No, not necessarily. Typically, you can always have the architect on board. In fact, you need to establish certain parameters before you go in for a design and build. And actually, contractually, it's a very, very challenging contract to manage at the initial stage. But if you get it right, then it can be also very, very
so,
beneficial.
So, a quick one for the advantage of the audience. If you had to recommend a design-build contract, how would you afford transparency of the cost to your client?
So that you were talking about transparency of cost. So that is actually not such a challenge. The challenge actually comes from what Sujatha has touched upon, what we are talking about earlier, which is change management. And the biggest challenge in our industry in India specifically is that we don't give enough time in pre-construction.
Absolutely.
See, we go and we want to fight a war without a battle plan. And that's when you run into a lot of trouble. It's like going into surgery without knowing what is my team of people going to be there. What do they need, each guy need to do?
As a pre-construction head, who better than you to know this? Dr. Adaniya, last word.
I'll put this way. Majority of the projects and things what you see are usually proprietary driven. So in my mind, I separate them two ways. Corporates, groups which have experience or who belong to the field. And second, a large chunk, in fact, a larger chunk is of people who drive the project by themselves. Over there, this will work better. And over here, where we have large groups having inside experience and expertise and teams of their own, that's where you're going to actually innovate and get creativity on. Expecting all the creativity to come from the architecture, I think it's too much for asking. They built up a good structure and team, might be not functionally efficient or not complying to beautiful looking building, but doesn't work well. The innovations, or the better designs, as Anupam showed across, what came across, those 20 years, pure 20 years ka nichod usmein aa gaya. That's where innovations and better things are.
So as we conclude, you know, we have a rich panel here, rich experience. Any two people, if they have questions, you know, we can put it to them, please.
What are the hurdles to complete the project on time? Is it a civil part or is it a equipment part?
To answer you, I'll give you the answer in three parts. The biggest hurdle that the project team would always face is actually analyzing what is the completion time. And to convey it is really very difficult. Okay, so that is the biggest hurdle that we would face. The second add-on to it would be what is the actual cost and the spread of the time and how you need to you know, fund flow the project. So project fund flow is very important to deliver it in time. The third is this side of people, I mean the consultants, who need to be, you know, true to what is expected from them on time. So unless and until all these three factors are on the same side, you cannot expect the time to be delivered, the project to be delivered in time.
Is it any other question?
But I think your question was something different. He was saying that is it the civil work or is it some other activity? Actually, today civil is not really the challenge. The challenge comes from all the coordination with the MEP, with the facade, with a lot of other, with the, especially in a hospital, it is also with the equipment which has to be brought in. So the challenge is more we are finding is not so much in civil anymore, because civil has moved quite a bit, where you have new technologies which can build slabs across in 4 days, 10-day cycle. We have very quick cycles, but it's the MEP works and the coordination of all of that which is a challenge for time.
Ipsita, with the lot of the questions from Samir, the change management.
That is what was dwelling on my mind. Dr. Jamdar, you had something to say?
It's okay.
Something more about this FIDIC, what is that, what exactly is it?
Dr. Jamdar, I think that will be a session in itself, so we'll take it up separately. Mr. Verma had something to say.
Yeah, I just wanted to highlight a little bit what we have not touched is the importance of in-house leadership of project management from the side of the promoter or the guy who's sending it. I think that is something which is much more make or break rather than...
Although the vision won't get translated the right way.
Yes.
And then comes the changes,
so the
then
guy
comes
who
the project.
Acts as a buffer between is something which is most important right from
day one.
Resisting the changes, and I have held that those positions because I had the diktat to change the midway the project, change the chairman's room from the left hand side
Vastu
to the right
compliance.
Hand side. right in the middle of the operation theater complex. So, I mean, those things. So, it is very important to have a in-house project management leadership, technical or non-technical, to actually act a buffer for the actual project management companies or just I've got to do that.
I think with this we'll conclude. Thank you, panelists, for wonderful insights that you provided. Thank you, audience.